My name is Christina Höök, or Kia Höök, or Professor Höök, if you can't pronounce the ö in my last name. And my talk, I think, unfortunately, a couple of you guys have already heard it, so I'm sorry about that. I'll try to make it interesting anyway, but anyway. I was just talking to one of my newest PhD students I have, this right before this meeting, and she said, I've understood that Soma design is actually extremely radical. And I was like, yes, it is radical. It is quite different. It is questioning quite a lot of values and ideas of what we're supposed to build, for whom we're supposed to build it, and so on. And so what I'm hoping is that some of you, at least, will get how radical this is. For others, it might look like a soft, very female practice, one where you question the whole idea, is this really rendering any important results? And that is also an interesting discussion to have. So with that kind of provocative opening, I'm going to go ahead and talk about Soma design. And to me, what has made me happy about Soma design is that it intertwines an understanding of aesthetics, ethics, and movement. And I will come back to what I mean by aesthetics. I think it took me several years to figure out what that means. And I will also come back to what I mean by ethics. And this is, I think, a hot topic for all of us working at KTH and Stockholm University and RISE and wherever you're working, because digital technologies are no longer the saviors of our lives solely. They're also being accused of doing quite horrible stuff to elections and to racial profiling and so on and so on. So ethics is something that we all need to care about these days. But without further ado, I'll just jump into it. So I love to show this picture, and this is actually me. It's my hand holding a tool that is 5,000 years old. And I came to hold it because I went to the Orkney Island with one of my colleagues from the US because she wanted to seek her roots, and her family was originally from the Orkney Islands. Anyway, so we went to this grave, this tomb there, and it was 5,000 years old, and we were allowed to touch some of the stuff there. And this was one of the tools that made immediate sense. So basically it's just a stone, but then somebody has chipped in, as you can see, these little marks that fit really nicely with your thumb. So you put your thumb on it, and then you can, it's obvious that you can use this to work with the fur or whatever it is that you're working with. And I was just like so mesmerized by this, you know, as an interaction designer, what if I could make something that would make sense to people 5,000 years from now? I doubt that anything we're doing right now will survive and will be as meaningful immediately to your body as this one. The second thing that fascinated me was they also had skeletons, 5,000 year old skeleton, human skeletons. And as you know, you can see on a skeleton whether somebody had big muscles or not, because you'll see it in the indents of the skeletons. Anyway, so these were, you know, really strong people, big muscles, they could work really, really hard. And so you can see, of course, a tool like this one, a heavy stone, and using that would shape your body to make you strong and muscular and so on. And I'm not going to comment on you guys and your bodies, but you know, it's kind of obvious that all of us are sitting in front of computers and not using big muscles to get our stuff done. And so the tools we put into people's lives will shape us. They shape what we can do, but they also shape our bodies in a very literal sense. They change our muscles, our nervous system reactions, the way we think about the world, the way we think we can survive and what we can do and whatnot. And so that's where our great responsibility lies, that the digital tools that we offer are going to change people. So this is why I've been searching for a foundation, a theoretical and practical foundation for my design work for many, many years. And I finally found it in the Soma design approach. So I thought I'd take you through a small Soma design exercise. So if you sit up on your chair, wherever you are, at home or KTH or Stockholm University or wherever you are, and you put your hands on your thighs and you close your eyes, and we're going to turn inwards a little bit. Put both of your feet on the floor and just feel how your feet are contacting the floor. And take a deep breath with me. Ooh. It's a beautiful day today. There's sunshine. And the world is a lovely place, not only a horrible place. So turn to your feet first and just register where your feet are today as they're resting on the floor. Your right foot, how is that resting on the floor? And your left foot, how is that resting on the floor? And if you compare the two, are they the same or are they different? So let us move upwards to your ankles and to your calves. Let's turn our attention to the right calf. Where is that today? Is it relaxed? Tensed? And your left calf? Where is that today? Is it tensed or relaxed? Now, if you compare the two, are they the same or are they different? So we move on to the knees, to your right knee. Can you feel whether it's like directly above your foot or maybe a little bit to the left or to the right or in front of or behind? And then you turn to your left foot and your left knee. Is that knee directly above, to the left or to the right of your foot? Maybe in front of or behind? And if you compare the two, can you feel whether your feet are pointing in the same direction or different directions? And your knees, are they pointing in the same direction or different directions? Now turn to your thighs and feel how they're resting on the chair. So I can't see your chairs, but mine is a soft chair. I can feel about half of my thighs resting on the chair. So turn your attention to your right thigh. How is that resting on the chair? Is it heavy or light? Now turn your attention to your left thigh. How is that resting on the chair? Is it heavy or light? And if you compare the two thighs, are they the same? Are they resting in the same way or different? Now turn to your sitting bones. If you don't know where your sitting bones are, you can lean a little bit forward, a little bit backward, and you will feel these two bones that are sticking down into the chair. You can lean a little bit to the left, a little bit to the right, and you can feel how your weight is shifting from one to the other. Now you can continue to lean a bit to the left, just a few millimeters, and then to the right. Now let's start imagining yet that your chair is following you. So as you lean to the right, it is trying to push you back. So the right side of the chair is pushing you back. And as you lean a little bit to the left side of the chair is pushing you back to the middle. As you lean a little bit forward, the chair is pushing you back. Or you lean a little bit backwards and it's pushing you back to the middle again. And as you're swaying a little bit back and forth, the chair is now changing its surface. It is now a very hard wooden chair. It's very uncomfortable. Can you feel it? And now it's changing again. It's getting soft. There's fur on top of it. Okay, we'll stop here. I hope that you were able to follow that, even though you might be at home or wherever you are. So what was I doing here? I was trying to help you imagine what it is like to work with shape-changing materials or robotic materials. So as you know, we're getting these new cool materials that can change their shape or their texture or their rigidness to be soft or hard or follow our movements in various ways. And how would you then work with designing a chair that could, you know, help you with your posture or engage with you and play games with you or whatnot if you had shape-changing elements in it? So these kinds of exercises where you turn your attention really very much inwards in order to figure out where is my sitting bones, where are they, what's going on, how could I do an interaction that is in harmony with or in disharmony with my body in order to achieve the kind of effects that I'm interested in. That is how we do Soma design in a short explanation. So let me show you a couple of examples a little bit more in detail. So we started working in this way many years ago, and originally we were working together with IKEA. I was leading a big research center called Mobile Life, and IKEA was one of our partners. And when you work with IKEA, what do you want to do? Obviously, you want to do interactive furniture, right? And so this is what we wanted to do, and they were really, really supportive, and we were allowed to use some of their experts in how to build furniture and so on as part of our project. And they said that they wanted to design furniture for the good life, for the many people, as they talk about it. And so health was one of the topics that they were interested in. So we were like, oh, I wonder what we could do that would be furniture that promotes health. Where would we take the inspiration? So we took inspiration from a body practice called Feldenkrais. Now, Feldenkrais is a particular movement practice that is a bit like if you've done yoga or if you've ever been to a naprapat or to a chiropractor or whatever. It is a particular movement practice that is supposed to help you if you have pain somewhere. But what we found fascinating was not so much the avoidance of pain, but instead the fun of it. So I'm going to show you one of my favorite lessons from the Feldenkrais exercises. So there's hundreds of different lessons depending on what you're training and what you're trying to get in contact with. And this particular lesson is about how to turn, and it's been shown by a baby in this video that I stole off the internet. So let's have a look at that, how babies learn how to roll. And you can imitate if you want to. Just turn off your video and you can go with the baby and do it. Thank you. obviously it always works to show babies in your presentation, doesn't it? We're all like mesmerized by this baby. So, but just to explain what is going on here. Well, imagine that you're an adult, not a baby, and you might be pregnant or you might be obese and you have issues with turning over in bed, for example. Then you can learn to coordinate your ways of moving in novel ways by deconstructing the movement and then figuring out how to do it in different ways. And so this is what Feldenkrais is trying to do. For me, I was more like, oh, this is so pleasurable. It's so much fun to lay on the floor in the office and roll back and forth holding my feet. So for me, it was not only that it could help me have a bigger repertoire of possible ways of rolling about on the floor. It was also the fun of it, the pleasure of it. So how could we use this to bring something interesting into our design work? So we built a bunch of many, many different things. As an interaction designer, what you do is you often bring out many, many different examples, and then the ones that capture your idea the best are the ones you keep. So one of them is this lamp that you can crawl in under. And as you're laying there, there's a sensor, and this is a very simple system. There's a sensor that measures your breathing rate, and then it dims the lamp in the same tempo as you're breathing. So here you see somebody's crawled underneath the lamp, and you can see the lamp and how it's dimming in the same tempo as this person is breathing. So the person laying underneath the lamp, here is my colleague at the time, Johanna. She's now working for Spotify. So maybe we'll see more cool design work from Spotify, who knows. So this was one. Another one we built was the Soma mat, we call it. It's basically helping you focus on different body parts by heating up underneath those body parts. So here you have Johanna again, she's on the floor, and we're trying to illustrate how the system is instructing her to focus on different body parts and how the mat then heats up. And this is lovely, and especially if you use these two systems together, you come into a very interesting, very sort of slowing down, turning inwards and getting a different understanding of your own breathing and of your own body. It's really amazing. We also built stuff that didn't work, but anyway, so these are two examples of stuff that did work. And how do I know that it worked? Well, we put it in people's homes for 3 months, and afterwards, and we did a lot of studies while they were using it, but also afterwards, and we had really interesting effects. So we had somebody, a 13-year-old daughter in one of the homes, saying that this changed her whole outlook on how to behave when she was giving talks and whatnot, because she would just focus inwards and she would be able to calm herself down and to be more grounded. And we were just mesmerized by that. We also had users who were crying when we took away the system. And that rarely has happened in my research life, that we built something that people find so important to them so that they're crying when we take back the system. So I said that this is about aesthetics. Now, I don't know what you think aesthetics is. I think my position on this a long time ago was very naive. I just thought it was about beauty. But of course, it's more complex than so. So aesthetics, in the way that I now use the term, I took from a philosopher named Richard Shustermanon, and he's here. He's the man in the golden suit in this picture, and he's now a good friend of mine. He sees aesthetics not as beauty, but as our ability to extract interesting things from the world through our senses. So to him, it's an awakening from the mindless, joyless behaviors of everyday life, and instead the ability to be there and to appreciate what you can see, what you can hear, what you can touch, how you're touched, what other people do, what you eat, when you have sex, all of these things, rather than doing them in the boring, habitual way that you've always done them, what if you can attend to them and extract more appreciation from what you see and feel and touch and hear? And so he put together this word aesthetics with the word soma. And why did he create this word soma? Well, it's because what we know, of course, about our bodies and our movements is that they are connected to our thinking. There is no dualism as Descartes thought that there was. There is no soul that exists somewhere outside of our bodies. We are our bodies. We are our movements. We are our subjectivity. That's how we are in the world, together with other people. And so instead of saying mind body, he says soma. So he put together the word soma with aesthetics to sort of say, this is an ideal for how to live your life. You engage through your subjective self, through your whole body, with the world around you. And he says, it's the highest art of all, that of living a better life. And I think this might annoy some of you. I hope it does, because it's basically giving me, or it gave me direction for, yeah, okay, so I want to design for a better life. What is a better life? And so I needed a way of approaching that. And this is what harmonizes with my worldview. So we can come back to that if you are disagreeing with me. I was also very inspired when I was working through what we mean by Soma design by another philosopher. Her name is Maxine Sheets Johnston. She was a choreographer and a dancer, and this is a photo of her dancing. But she also turned to philosophy, and she discovered that in philosophy and in many of the sciences, whenever we talk about the body, we talk about it in a way that is basically the male body, right? And it's basically very low status. We don't think that the body is anything but some kind of machinery that carries around our beautiful mind, right? And as a dancer, this was really weird to her, because to her, meaning making and the way that we are in the world is with our bodies. There's no way of separating the body from the mind. And so she says, movement is primary. Language is secondary. And how can she say so? Well, just look at babies. They start by moving, and they know and understand and make meaning out of what they see, hear, feel, touch, even before they have any language to talk about this. So intelligence, to her, is enacted in action, in and through movement of the whole soma. And this makes sense. If you look at animals and whatnot, of course, language is important to people. Of course, it's a magical innovation. It's amazing, but it's secondary. The movement is where we are and how we behave in the world. She also says this other thing that I think was inspirational to me as a designer, namely that when you're acting, your emotions will, of course, influence what you can think about, but also how your body is responding. And so she even goes as far as saying that without certain corporal tonicities, a certain feeling would not and indeed could not be felt, and a certain action would not and indeed could not be taken, since the postural dynamic of the body are what make the feeling and the action possible. So for many of you, I think you know about emotional research and how emotion is something that motivates us to do something. So if there was a lion coming into my bedroom right now, I would be inclined to move, right, out of the way of this lion. And so emotion, like fear, creates certain hormonal reactions, certain tonicities in the body, and makes me respond and act in the moment. And this is also something we can then use in our design work. And so this was really key to some of my thinking in how to do design. So I've already given you two examples, the soma mat and the breathing light, but let me give you some of the latest work that we've been doing, because that work was in 2015, 16. So since then, we've been like, can we build something else? Or was this a one-off? So here is some of the stuff. If you come and see us whenever this COVID shit is over with, you're most welcome to come to our office in Lindstedtsvägen 5, floor 6, and to see some of the design work we're doing now. So on the left-hand side, you have one of my PhD students, Pavel. He's engaging with mental health issues that people might have. And he's working with deep pressure therapy. I don't know if you know this, but sometimes when you're super anxious, a really strong embrace for a long while can calm you down. So the corset he's wearing has these inflatable or shape-changing elements that can change the shape of the corset. So step by step, you can become sort of squeezed or even encouraged to do more deep breathing, breathing all the way into your belly and so on. The middle picture of that chair, it is a chair that you can sit on and you have this big bulky thing in between your legs. And as you sit on it, the middle part of it, if you look, if you compare the left-hand picture with the right-hand picture, you can see how it's inflating. And so here the idea is to train the pelvic floor muscle. I don't know if you know where you have it. The women in the audience, the ones who've had babies, probably know that you need to train this one. So basically that muscle is going across your torso. And if you're really skilled, you can tense it at the clock number 12 or 6 or 9 or 3. Or you can release it in various ways. And so this chair is helping you to figure out where is the muscle and how do I tense it and what is it that I'm supposed to tense. So the pelvic chair is one example. We also worked with some people in Nottingham who are really cool work around guitar playing and performance and stuff. And we created a guitar that breathes. So here we have shape-changing elements that will breathe in a tempo that helps you calm down. So this was based on a couple of them are performers. So they perform on stage and they say when you get really nervous, you don't play as well, right? So you're playing the guitar, but you're really nervous, so you get all stiff. One of the reactions that the human body has when we get nervous is that we stop breathing, right? And so the idea here is that the guitar, perhaps not while you're on stage, but when you're training, could sort of help remind you to breathe again, and even to help you calm down your breathing when you're playing something really difficult. Because that relaxes you and it makes the performance better. And then we have a couple of breathing wings that Vasiliki made for herself. So there's sort of breathing in certain tempo on her shoulders or what do you call the shoulder blades. So yeah, anyway, so this is all the weird, some of the weird stuff we do. We also have a group of, in my research group, there's also the group that does female health. So the pelvic chair was one example. Another one are these menstruation bits. So basically the idea here is that when you're a teenager and you have your first menstruation, it is really interesting. It changes your body dramatically. It changes your life dramatically. And it takes a while to get to know this new body. And so here the idea is that you would be given some kind of reflection toolkit that allows you to sort of explore what is going on. So the leftmost picture is if you take a little bit of mucus from down there and you put it on your mobile, then you can see what is in the blood when you're menstruating. The picture in the middle is when you're fertile, then the mucus from down there looks different. The picture on the right-hand side are ways of getting a massage or figuring out where is this pain, what is going on with my uterus and also with my eggstockar, the other female parts that I can't remember the English word for right now. Any which way, so this is some of the stuff we've done. There's also commercial work based on artists' work. So I have a friend in Australia who designed from a Soma design perspective named George Kutt. And he's done all of those biofeedback installations in art museums, but that was also turned into a commercial product to help kids who are going through hospital care and who has to survive a lot of, you know, syringes and probing and whatnot. And so this is a system that helps you calm down. So it's listening to your brain waves and it's helping you. If you calm down, the animations on the screen become slower and more relaxing. And so you can enter into what we call a biofeedback loop, learn to control your fear or your other emotions, whatever they are. There's also work on, for example, remote controls, which is like an everyday object. And here's one by my colleagues in Eindhoven. So they did this remote control for music, and it has a lot of haptics in it. So here's somebody listening to music. Picks up, and you can hear the sound increasing. So you get a stronger connection to the activities you do around the music. Changing music, changing playlists and whatnot. And the system, and what you can't see is how the system is giving haptic feedback to you. So I think you just have to imagine that. Another of my colleagues is also happens to be in Australia as well, again, is Josef Ladelfa. He's been working with some Swedish researchers, and I'm actually his co-supervisor. He's been doing these amazing drones that you can do Tai Chi with. So this is me, and next to me is Josef Ladelfa. And as you see, that tiny little thing there is a drone. And I can move with it, but it's a bit slow, so it slows down my movement and makes me do almost this Tai Chi kind of movement. Okay, so all of these systems that I just showed you, not all of them are from me or our research group. Some of them are from across the globe, and there are many, many more examples. They are all sort of dealing with the same kind of manifesto, namely that we should be able to design better stuff for people to have in their everyday life. And they should be designed so that everything we do becomes more interesting to us. I don't mean that it has to be pleasurable. It can also be scary or annoying or demanding or whatever, but it needs to engage us beyond just thinking about the world as something where we try to get our work stuff done as efficiently as possible. So designing for living a better life and not for dying. That's a weird thing to say, but it is really going back to Plato and Aristotle and so on, and moving the passions in ourselves and others, and recognizing that we are movement, and designing with ourselves through empathy and compassion. Designing slowly so that we care about the meaning-making processes that we put in the hands of end users. And the last two ones, I'll just show you what we do. So we work a lot with trying to figure out what we can do with our bodies and our movements and our emotions. We go slow walking in the forest behind KTH, or we do contact improv dancing, or all sorts of other weird stuff, depending on what we're designing. We're also working quite a lot with trying to figure out what has become habitual that we need to change because it gives us pain or it doesn't give us pleasure anymore. So if you interlace your fingers and then you do it the other way around, that makes it non-habitual to you, right? Or you do this, and then you do it the other way around, and that makes the movement non-habitual. So that makes it possible for us to figure out what could we do that disrupts or changes something that you're doing every day and that you no longer notice and that has become ingrained with you, and make it more overtly available to change and to work and to create more richness in life. So here, for example, we did a lot of work with sourdough baking because it's so sensual and interesting. And then we used that to build interactive devices for controlling music or whatever, you know. And here's another example where we're building a VR application for walking on a tightrope, and we're putting vibration under the feet of the poor person on the tightrope. The VR is also slightly tilting her world. And so on. So that's what we do. So why is this about aesthetics? I think I've said it several times, but I'll say it again. So it is about deepening your sensory appreciation of the world, of everything you do, of eating, of going to work, of sitting on the bus, of sitting on a chair, of your own pelvic floor muscle, whatnot. Appreciating it, really going deeply into it, both for the designer and for the user. And in that sense, it forms an ideal for what a good life is, in that the whole point is tried to liberate you, to open up to more possibilities, more experiences. And to us and to many other research groups across the globe, this has been generative in that it creates a lot of design ideas, which makes me happy. So it wasn't only a few design examples, but it seems to work for a lot of stuff, even for boring website design and stuff like that. Okay, and then I said it was also intertwined with ethics. And this is my most recent research project. So we got some money from Marianne and Marcus Wallenberg for WASP-HS. So that is looking at AI and looking at it from the humanities and social science and artistic point of view. Anyway, so we're going to explore ethics. What is ethics? How do we design already from day one with an understanding of ethics? And the reason I wanted to explore this is because this guy, Shusterman, that I stole all my ideas from, the philosopher, he says that while modernity's dominant ideology compartmentalizes and trivializes the aesthetics by sharply distinguishing it from more serious realms of knowledge and praxis, by identifying the aesthetic with mere prettiness, appearance, surface, form, play, fantasy, etc., some aesthetics blends aesthesis, cognition, and praxis to address some of philosophy's most central aims: knowledge, self-knowledge, right action, happiness, and justice. Okay, and so you go like, what? How can rolling about on the floor and then designing for that be a way of engaging with right action and justice? I can see how it engages with knowledge and self-knowledge, because I learn about myself. And once I learn about myself, I can present myself to the world in other ways. I can engage with empathy and compassion and so on. And I can see that is important. Why does it lead to right action and justice? So let's see. So we did a study where we analyzed building drones for the opera stage. Yeah, weird project. But anyway, and we were looking for three aspects of ethics. So one is the self-cultivation and care and self-knowledge, because that is ethics, isn't it? I need to take care of myself in order to be in the world in a good way. But I also need to care and have empathy towards others, right? That's a second super important part of ethics. And in order to do that, I need to have possibilities to choose. If I'm forced into a situation where I have no choice, then there's no way I could do the right action, right? Okay, so this is not all that ethics is. This is just three things that we started with looking at. So that stone I showed you in the beginning of the talk, I said that it immediately made sense to me, that I could touch it, I could feel it, I could use it. It was a tool. It enabled me to do more things in the world that I couldn't do without the tool, right? Because it's heavy, it's strong, it can do stuff for me. And the designer who left this tool for me left, in that sense, a set of sedimented movements for me to engage with. I put my thumb here, and then the stone is really like firmly placed in my hand, and I can do these things. So that allows me to do certain movements. And that is where ethics arises. It's emergent and dynamic in the relationship between my body and what I do with this tool. Yeah, maybe. So let's look at these, the example we took. So we were working, or rather it was Hedvig Källström who was working with Åsa Unandeskerin and Carl Unandeskerin, because they wanted to build some drones to be used on the opera stage. And I was part of the project because I had some money left over, and I was also interested in the design process that Åsa, the dancer and choreographer, and Carl, who's an opera composer and singer, how they wanted these drones to behave in order to be willing to put them on the stage, to be willing to see them as part of this opera. And they actually work, and there is an opera, and it's going to be more exhibitions of this in the KTH Reactor Hall. You should look out for that. It's super cool. Anyway, how on earth is this about ethics, human drone interactions? How can that be ethics? So let's have a look at how Åsa finally got the drones to work in a way where she can be expressive. They're noisy and they're singing, and she's dancing with them. And if you look at her body, you can see that she's pretty relaxed about it. Fully capable of moving with two drones, and they're big and they're scary and they might harm her. But she's able to direct them and work with them. Okay? And now she's landed one of them in the floor. Now compare this to my master student, Sara, who is no longer a master student. She's now a PhD student at Stockholm University. So Sara Eriksson, she also danced with these drones as a way of understanding them. And you can look at her body language. You can notice how scared she is. She's very stiff and her movements are very much close to her body. And she's a bit scared to come even close to one of these drones. So what is going on here? Well, first of all, the drones had to be constructed to be expressive and interesting, and so Åsa wanted them to be scary, but she also wanted them to come close to her body. And so she figured out ways of getting them programmed so that they could come close to the body. But in that, she had to learn to change her movements so that she could move in a way that she could take care of herself and increase her knowledge of what she could express between herself and this drone. And as she saw Sarah, she came up to Sarah afterwards and said, "I can see that you were scared, and I can see that this is you're not comfortable with these drones." So by changing herself and then observing someone else, she could come to a better care and empathy also towards others who were trying to act together with the drone. And here she's explaining how to move in a way where you can get the drone to move in an interesting and smooth way. So why is this about then freedom of choice? Well, it shouldn't, you know, freedom of choice is not confused, shouldn't be confused with what is pleasant or unpleasant or good or evil. Because we need the choices in order to make that, you know, we need the alternatives in order to make those choices. And in this case, Åsa wants the drones to be scary, and she wants the expression to be passion on stage. This is Medea killing her daughters and whatnot, right? And so this is where the creativity and the expression comes from. But she wants that freedom to act together with the drones in a rich way. And only then can she do this way of dancing that is expressive in the opera. Ah, yeah, I'll move on. So this is how we analyze that stuff as a way of coming to expressivity and choice, sometimes through the unpleasant and the scary. So to me, Soma design and ethics are deeply intertwined. When I design a drone, it is shaping Åsa, it's shaping the drones, and it's also shaping ethics in terms of dynamic and emergent interactions that can be leading to interesting expressions or boring expressions. So I think I'll skip the habit. This is Aristotle and habits and what ethics is usually enacted as habits. I'll skip that because I can see that I should stop. So anyway, for me, Soma design then intertwines aesthetics, ethics, and movement. And through a deepened somatic awareness, a social awareness of others, and enactment of bodily freedoms rather than limitations, and aesthetic experience and expression. I know there might be some students in this lecture and they have read some of my papers before, and they're like, "But how can you do this stuff? It all sounds so unscientific, this first person subjective way of engaging. So I thought I'd just end with a quote by Sheets Johnston, the philosopher I was quoting before. I was reading this the other day. It's a book called The Roots of Morality. I love it. She's so funny. And she says, somewhere in the book, she says, the first implication of the analysis, therefore, specifies an awakening to and an incorporation of the subjective. People within the human sciences who are engaged in studies of human morality or whose work dovetails with studies of human morality, not only sociobiologists, but medical personnel, cognitive scientists, evolutionary psychologists, and so on, are charged with awakening to the way in which the subjective is bound up with what they consider the objective. So, she says, the subjective presents a methodological problem, but only for those raised and bred on a diet of behaviorism. I love this. Oh, maybe you're not getting it. I don't know. But to me, this is like, fuff, 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 on all of those people who believe that an objective stance is a true stance. Of course, it's not. So by that, thank you all. And I'm happy to take questions. And please buy my book. I'd like to get rich. I haven't got rich yet on it. So please buy it. So thank you.